Welcome to the College of Complexes, everybody. My name's Don, and I'm the moderator this evening. Now, our program tonight is author Sonja Perdue is going to be talking about her book, Asking the Tough Questions. This is Black America, Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions by Sonja Cassandra Perdue. It's a formalized five-part Q&A discussion that begins July 2010. The series of books will challenge Black America to collectively engage in a dialogue designed to initiate solutions to our collective concerns and issues. Now, all right, well, in that case, let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker, Sonja Perdue. Yay.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone.
Okay, I want to pull the mic down a little.
I've been here before. I want to thank you for inviting me again. Thank you. And it's always a pleasure. I think I was here in 2014 and spoke of my book at that time, which was Black America, Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions, and I'll talk about that. And then I returned, and I can't remember what year that was, maybe it was 2015. Jimmy Tillman Jr., who was the son of Dorothy Tillman, was running for Congress for Bobby Rush's seat, and I was here that night. He spoke, and one of my key partners for Chicago Street Journal, I missed that night, Ron Carter spoke here one night. Chicago Street Journal is a Southside newspaper, and hasn't been published in a while, but he's trying to bring it back. And make it a citywide newspaper. But I'm not going to say how prepared I am.
I'm not.
I am stretching myself this thin. I had another event today at Sherman Park Branch Library, which was a job and skills event. I wanted to, as part of what I do, and I'll talk a little bit about that, of course, I wanted to have a volunteer arm and do some different things that I feel that are needed in the Southside community. Most of the time, I've lived on the North Side, so I moved on the South Side like in March of last year, and there's a vacuum, as everyone knows, economics, education, businesses, just name anything, and there's a vacuum on the South Side as well as the West Side. That's what causes these poverty pockets. So I felt the need to make a contribution, and my contribution, and talked to the branch librarian, who was called Lala, I felt that I wanted to, you know, as much as possible, bring training programs. We have job fairs, we have a lot of job fairs, but we do need training for these positions. And there are a lot of organizations and nonprofits that talk training. So I set up the skills and job training event to bring in people to the Sheraton Park Branch Library so that the community can be face-to-face with people who are offering job skills enhancement and job training. So that's what I was doing today, on top of coming over here tonight and speak, which I do always enjoy being here. And I would love to come more often. I, in somewhat preparing to speak tonight, I think the first thing I have here, it says, my. What a pickle we've gotten ourselves into, haven't we?
What are you talking about?
I don't have to tell you. Yeah. Everybody got their own idea from that statement. What a pickle we've gotten ourselves into. Saw yesterday that the Pope stated that it's better to be an atheist than to be a bad Christian.
A good atheist.
Than a bad Christian. Doing one thing and saying another. He also indicated that the church owes a lot of people apologies. I've always felt that apologies don't really fix anything, but it's good of him to say that. So, and then woke up this morning, because this is every day, woke up this morning and the White House is attempting to suppress the news. And it just says, what next? But we've seen all this before. History is repeating itself. But the difference, there's quite a difference. I understand when the printing press got to going and they started distributing books and leaflets and people were having more access to communications that they suppressed it then. Catholic Church covered it, the Bible, covered it, the books. Things couldn't be printed without their permission. So it's not the first time that it's happened, but it's a little bit different this time. When you try to suppress the press in 2017, we have to look at the numbers. Just look at HuffingtonPost.com online. They're hitting about 400, where it says 492 million page views a month. How do you suppress them? If you look at the Washington Post, they're hitting about 350,000 page views per month. How do you stop them? By not inviting them to your press reviews. USA Today hitting about 500,000 page views a month. New York Times hitting about 571 page views a month. MSN.com hitting over a million page views per month. So you're trying to suppress the press when really they're distributing more information than you actually are. Bloomberg, 200,000 a month. So, and this goes on and on. Forbes, 300 million a month, Forbes. So when you're putting out that much information to people, fake news or real news, Fox News, 800 million views a month. 800 million views a month. When you're putting out that much information, you are controlling the mindset of the country. The White House seems to, and I'm sure you're going to come back to this, seems to be trying to control the mindset. The White House is one entity. These news medias, and this is just in 15, 52, this is just the top 20. We can go on and on and on and on. In addition to those numbers, MSN 1,992,000 page views per month. If we go on and on and on with that, Donald Trump has 25 million followers. There's a big difference in 25 million and 1,992,000. He may not know it, but there is. If you look at Twitter, CNN followers are 32 million. New York Times has 38 million. They're already ahead of him. Barack is ahead of everybody with 85 million. So if you look at Facebook, 1.8 billion people on Facebook. And I'm not sure, most of you are on Facebook, aren't you?
Yeah.
Most of,
I am.
Okay. If you're going, and let me tell you why these numbers are important to me. What I do is social media, really. That is what my company is, Chicago's Black Business Network. We're a social media management and training organization. So I look at matrix and look at numbers, and the numbers are important, and I'm like, who are you suppressing? You put them out of your press conference, but you can't stop the news. How would you stop the news? Unless you shut down the internet. And that would be the only way. And I do expect them to attempt that. That's just my view. If you look at 1.8 billion people on Facebook every day, 300 plus million on Twitter every day, Instagram and Snapchat, chat are even ahead of Twitter. About 800 million on those two. That would be the only way that you could stop the news, any news whatsoever. You would have to shut down the internet. So I don't know strategically what they're doing up in the White House, but I don't think they're going to stop the news. And I started that way because that's how it came to me this morning, because it's like every day. And let me tell you something that's going on, and then I'll introduce myself, I guess. Because there were so many conversations when I walked in regarding number 45, I thought I would touch on that this morning, and I'm sure you're going to have some feedback. When 45 first came in the office, or really before his inaugural, excuse me, I wrote a blog which is titled, Trump is the Poison and We Are the Cure. And this is not even what my book is about, but it's what we are about. The left, the right, the middle, fascist, socialist, this, that, the other. What has happened, we have lost our concentration. If I run down the same Facebook friends, the same social media, Twitter feed line, everything is Trump at 45. I mean, it's just overwhelming. Whereas before, people had a whole lot of other conversations before that. But now it's just overwhelming with discussing this administration.
Well, you said that I don't know what you said, is that if I asked one more time, you would leave.
If indeed all of our emotions are chemical reaction, all of them, and from my understanding, the negative emotions have a negative effect on your body, that they bring about disease, okay? And there's a lot of hate spewing out there, a lot, just, I call it a civil war on social media. If you're not totally into civil war, you're not totally watching this battle, okay? There is a war going on social media. The left and the right are fighting. It just wasn't like this before November 8th. It was always back and forth. I mean, with the Obama administration and that type of thing, it was always back and forth. Black, white, this, what, that. It was not like it is right now. This is not a black, white thing. I have never seen white people as pissed off. Never. And I told my friend, I said, well, I'm just going to sit back and let white people fight it out. I mean, what the hell is going on here? You can go to a thread, and this will be repeated thousands upon thousands upon thousands of times, and I do not exaggerate what I'm saying right now. You can go to a thread, let's say Overtime with Bill, what's his name, Bill Meyer? You can go to that Facebook page, and they can post a thread about Donald Trump and say something derogatory about him. And there would be 5,000 people sharing that thread, and 15,000 people commenting on it, and it's just fight. I may be deadening just a little bit. But there could be 2,500 shares, and it's just fight, just go on. And that would be one thread. And then there are thousands of those threads. Sometimes I just sit down and get a cup of coffee or a glass of wine. I just sit down and read them. Every now and then I jump in and throw some mud. I just sit down and just read the rhetoric that is going back and forth. These people, if they could sit in the room and really feel uninhibited like they do behind the keyboard, will actually shoot, kill, scratch each other's eyes out, torture each other, blow each other's houses up. This is how deep the anger is that is going back and forth. And this administration brought this forward. I think that is a bad thing and not a bad thing, that we need to know the truth about how people feel and about how we feel. That's not the bad thing. But I think in saying that he's a poison, that his supporters feel that they are not affected by this hate in their support for him and their rhetoric back and forth. Well, these negative emotions affect you just like they affect me in the back and forth fight. These are chemical reactions in our body that bring about disease, bring about emotional stress, bring about illness. Hate is not a beneficial emotion. It can be traced back to all types of disease. And I think that we know that. So this is not a benefit to anyone, what's taking place right now. It absolutely is poisoning not only our relationships, it's poisoning the whole globe. On the Women's March, and I can't remember what day that was. I don't think that was, maybe it was his inaugural, I don't know, when they were wearing the little pink pussy hats, which was totally blowing my mind, because I went into a thread, and all these women were talking about how they were going to get their little pink pussy hats. That some of them were knitting pink pussy hats. Have we ever had a discussion about this in our lives? Have you ever heard anything like this? People exchanging information on how to knit, how to buy, having comments about their wearing their pink pussy hats. How low have we got? How far have we gone? This is an example of what this administration has brought about. Discussions about pink pussy hats. I just could not believe this. All this knitting and buying things and going back and forth. Never heard anything like that before. But anyway, to say that this is not healthy for us, it's not helpful for us, it's not beneficial for us, even though the Trumpkins think they've won. You haven't won. In the end, it has divided the globe. Because I couldn't figure out in London why were 80,000 women marching on the day of the Women's March. Over in London, I'm like, why are they marching? You know, this is what is bringing forth on this globe. So it's not only affecting America. It's affecting the globe, and it's poisoning the globe. And I just want to take that's my position. I want to take that with you. My book is Black America Asking Ourselves the Tough Question. Like I said, Chicago's Black Business Network, and if you go online, you'll see my website. Then I put up myself. I'm learning how to be a webmaster. I got 20 jobs here like everybody else. I do partner with a PR firm. So we do place ads for business owners in these major magazines. Bloomberg, Huffington Post. We do have the means for a price to get articles written in these major publications, and that's part of what we do. I do manage social media accounts for people. My goal is really to help small businesses get more exposure. That would be my first thing that I would do. By using my social media accounts, if they don't have social media accounts, they can use mine. And I charge a fee for that. And I was thinking today, I listened to Billy Crystal's audio, still fooling around. It was available. I downloaded it, listened to it free from the library. And I'm pretty much a fan of Billy Crystal. I've watched him over the years. It was a good book because he's in his 60s now. I'm in my 60s. He said some really funny things about old people, too. Some things I never thought about. I'm glad he's in good health, too. But he made a reference. He used to do the, some impressions, but he used to do the Howard Cosell Muhammad Ali impression. And him and Muhammad Ali became friends because of that. He did some roasts for Muhammad Ali as part of that, and they became friends as a result. I think he did Sammy Davis Jr. as well. Now, Muhammad Ali called him one day. This is what he said in the audio book, and he read his own audio book as well. He said that Muhammad Ali called him one day and asked him to go golfing with him. And so Billy Crystal told him that he couldn't go golfing with him because that club was restricted. Muhammad Ali said to him, he said, well, I'm Muslim, they let me in. He said, but I'm Jewish and they won't let me into that club. And Muhammad Ali said to him, well, I won't go back then, and he never did. So as I look at what's taking place right now, I want to take the same stand that Muhammad Ali took about, I want to give the same support that he did to Billy Crystal. There's a lot to be said for deporting people, whether it's Muslims or whether it's Mexicans. There's a lot of debate on letting people into the country. There's a lot of debate on refugees. There are people starving. Sudan had gone back into a famine. People denying medicine because of money, medicines that they need because of money, because they can't afford it. I want to stand the same way that Muhammad Ali stood, that I can't support them doing something to you that I would not want done to me. And that goes for the Mexicans, the refugees, the immigrants, and any and everyone else.
Puerto Rican too?
And the Puerto Ricans, my dear.
Okay, thank you.
If he can stand and say that he won't go for that, then I can too. I'm not saying that controls don't need to be put into place. As far as the Mexican immigration, that was messed up a long time ago. That's like anything else. If you let it get out of control, there was something you're supposed to do a long time ago to put it in check. If that's what you feel, there were so many illegals, but you were using people. And now you don't feel like you want to use them anymore, so now you're going to deport them. But I have to stand on the sides, Dakota. I have to stand on the sides of these people. There is nothing in me that says, no matter what, I can support people having water hoses on them in cold weather. I don't care what you're doing. I don't care what you're trying to do. I don't care what you're doing. If they're not being violent towards you, attacking you, I can't stand for any of that. And the reason I cannot, and this is my personal statement, am I next? Are you next? What will they find next to say that you can't do, you won't do, that is against the law? You can't say, because every day that we wake up, it is something new that this administration has decided that they were going to do. And what will they do to you next? So I can't stand for what is currently taking place. Let's talk about the book. It's just impromptu. Oh, I want to say, before I talk about the book, there was a conversation about mortgages. That I overheard. I was a mortgage broker. I actually was a loan officer. I was not a broker. I did mortgages from 2000 to 2007. I worked for about three companies. I worked for a company on the south side. Then I worked for Royal Bank of Canada. Then I worked for Pan American Bank. Then I worked for another bank in on North Avenue. And I worked for another bank somewhere in Berwyn. So I worked for about five companies. So I know a little bit about mortgages and how that works. And one thing we must understand about that, and I'm going to tie up and then I'm talking about the book for about 10 minutes. One thing we must understand about that is that the people who run this country do not wake up, except for number 45, do not wake up and just make their decisions like that. These are 10, 20, 30 year plans. When they're rolling out Greenspan, you see how he disappeared. When they're rolling out the plans, economic plans for this country, they know exactly what's about to happen. There's no, make no mistake about it. They know exactly what's about to happen. When the banks were selling loans and making the loans easier and easier for people to get, they were doing no-doc loans. They were reducing the credit requirements for loans. All of these things were about money and immediate money. Make no mistake that they did not know what was about to happen with those mortgages. They knew exactly what was about to happen with those mortgages. They did these 3 to 5 year ARM mortgages for people who had credit problems and said, well, 3 to 5 years, you fix your credit and you'll be able to refinance at a better rate. Well, those days didn't come and they lost their houses. People who had a credit lost their houses, a lot of them, because they changed the percentage rate, the loan to value rate on the houses. The appraisal value, the appraisals all over the country, the value of the property fail. Therefore, many, many people could not refinance their homes. Believe me, they knew. When they gave these high-risk loans, they took the money and ran. Uh-huh. People who could barely spell were loan officers, making $150,000 a year, have been washing cars somewhere, you know. But they came and they did loans, okay? They had a connection. No, lady, she had been a waitress, but she met another woman whose father sat on the board of a major hospital. She hooked up with that lady, married as a matter of fact, and got that connection to start doing these large loans, making more money than she's ever made in her whole entire life. We're talking like $500,000 a year. Because they, you know, they got the connections. They had the connections. I'm over there doing loans on the people on the south side, and it's a whole different story, believe me. Our income levels are just not the same. A guy, I did an interview with Fox Interview back then sometime. He asked me, did I feel guilty about the loans that I did? I said, no. Because when I did my job as a loan officer, and someone mentioned this too, I sit down, I explain the process, I ask everybody to sit down with a notebook, read through these papers, call me back and ask me any questions you want. You know what? You think they call me back? Nope. You think they had a lot of questions about it? Nope. They wanted the house or they wanted the money they was getting out the house and they went on with it and most of them lost their homes because they would not listen. So I'm just saying that that is by plan. People who managed their money before, well before the crisis, were able to manage it and maybe make it through afterwards. But there were not many of them, okay? The book, Black America Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions. As a matter of fact, I didn't bring any books, but if you go on Amazon and Google my name, Sonja Cassandra Perdue, it will be free on Tuesday and Wednesday of this week for you. If I don't forget, I'll have to make a note. So, since I didn't bring any books, you can get the ebook Tuesday and Wednesday. Excuse me.
All right, thank you.
You're very welcome. Black America Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions. It's really a very, very thin book. I was in a rush. I had a date set to publish the book, and I was told Charles when I said I was speaking tonight that I'll have the second book out. I'm overwhelmed. I am absolutely overwhelmed. So I don't, but eventually one day I do hope to. But it is a dialogue for Black America. Black America Asking Ourselves the Tough Questions. It's a dialogue that I set up between Black America to ask, a conversation between ourselves. Even if this type of form, it will be great. Or coffee shops, book clubs, wherever the case may be. And it's about 90 pages, And I'm going to read the first question from the book just to give you an idea of how it goes. And this applies not only to Black America, it can apply to any ethnic group, and you can plug yourself in it, okay? Tough question number one. Imagine that you are a Black man in the year is 1955. You're walking down the street in a community called Bridgeport, and four white men pull up beside you in a Chevy. Are you afraid? The year is 1964, and a young Black man driving down a dark road on their way, and a young Black man is driving down the road on his way to Meridian, Mississippi with two Jewish associates. When they see bright lights of a car in their rearview mirror, then they see a flashing red light and know that that is a police vehicle. Do you feel safe or are you forever regretful? Imagine that you are a Black man in the years 2010 or 2017, and you're driving through Chicago's Inglewood community and you quite appropriately stop at a stop sign. Before you can pull off, four Black men pull up next to you. Are you scared? Where do you as a Black American feel safe? Where do you feel threatened? Why are we still afraid? Haven't we been afraid long enough? As I was saying, I moved to the South Side in March of last year. Most of the time I've been spent back and forth, but most of the time during my adult life, I lived out of town or I lived up north. I do know that Black people have been paranoid forever on the South Side, and not only because of white people, because of Black people too, and the level of violence there. And I'll give you an example. I was standing at the bus stop, and this lady, she was across the street, and she was waving at me. And I'm like, waving back at her. And I'm like, I can't hear what you're saying, you know? So I walked over to hear what she was saying, you know? And she said, you can't stand with your back to people walking up on you, because it was just two black men walking down the street toward me. And so she was telling me not to stand by the bus stop and let people walk up behind me. I'm like, are you kidding? Are you for real? She said, you can't let people walk up behind you. Like, if they're gonna do something to me, if I'm looking at them, what am I gonna do anyway? I'm like, this is too unreal. I just told her, okay, you know. But I'm just not gonna be that frightened, but I am gonna be cautious. I'm just gonna go with the flow. But they are afraid, they are frightened, and my question is, when will that stop? Obviously, they don't have the solution, otherwise they would have stopped it. It's the city's responsibility to protect its citizens, and it has not protected the citizens of Chicago. It is the city's responsibility to protect the citizens of its city, and it has not done it. Black America asking ourselves the tough questions. We go through a whole lot of questions that people go through anyway. It's no race that doesn't have the same type of questions about our culture, about our hair, skin color, our language usage, the whole gamut. The next book, and I won't tell you the title of it because I haven't recorded the ISBN yet. But the second book is about in Black America, as I stand here today and as I perceive myself today, if you were to take everything that I was taught by white America, I probably would disappear. Everything that I was taught by white America about myself, the English language, I would not speak this language, the religion, I would not, which I'm agnostic anyway, but we would not be practicing the Christian religion, which most of them are. We would not wear the clothes that we wear. We would not have the thought process. Our culture would be different. Our hair would be different. If you stripped us of everything that white America has taught us, who would we be? And that's almost applicable to all Americans, because it's very blended. But who would we be? Because everything that we are as Black Americans was taught to us by white Americans. We did not bring this here with us. And so who would we be? And at this time, is it time to redefine who we are? So that would be what the second book is about and what I will be writing about on the second book. I'm not sure if this is the point where you answer questions, I sit down and you come back, you ask questions. How is that? How do we work that?
We ask questions next.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I'm standing right here?
Oh, yeah, you stay and answer the questions. It's not me that answers the questions.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe I'd sit down and
No. You all stay right. And answer the questions.
But thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, you know, well, we'll get into the question and answer session. Who's got a question? Tim, go ahead.
All right. Considering that you're saying that a lot of changes have come about with the development of the internet and social media and the whole thing, you know, when I look back, I see the real change in society was with the development of the telegraph. My question to you is, I guess what I'm trying to say is, I'll have to address this in my book. You said you're into social media, you said you're into things like this. Do you see the internet as a liberating force for a lone person to give voice to people who do a lot of things, or do you find it's more a way of suppression for the Black person?
I love social media. I think it's a liberating force, maybe too liberating. It's a liberating force for everyone. I think we know people more than we really need to know them. But people are free to use social media as they wish. That's part of a greater freedom that we have. Do we want to stop that in order to define what their freedom should be? Don't say this, don't do that. You can't say this, you can't do that. That would be denying them what their freedom is. I think it's very liberating. I've learned things that I haven't wanted to learn on social media. I mean, things I've never heard or seen before. So I think it's very liberating. Something changed. It changed the media. It changed what journalists get paid, because not everybody and their granddaddy is a journalist. People have blogs everywhere. It changed TV. It changed everything. People produce movies. People produce plays on there. YouTube is an example. People record any and everything. Podcasts. People have their own news shows. I've recorded over 300 podcasts. Interviewed about 300 people almost. So it changes everything. People have a voice they never had. I kind of thought that, you know, Telegram did do a lot, but I think even going way back to the printing press, that I think that was the cusp that really started to change, and that's when they stepped up and tried to control that and you know, cease and desist. They did not want that information going out, just as they don't want it going out now. But we've gone too far. Yes, sir.
Oh yes. Actually, I forgot to mention Sonja. I call on the on the people.
I'm
going to
let you do that.
Okay. But you. Okay, Jordan.
Well, I think you're part of the problem because you can't accept that Trump won the election. And I'm saying, why can't Blacks give Trump a chance? You gave Obama a chance, but you won't give Trump a chance. He's got the power to help you, people, Blacks.
I can't accept the fact that he won the election. I can accept that, and I can accept that it's a nightmare ever since day one. I accept that he won. I'm not denying that he did not win. I mean, there's an argument out there about it, but it's irrelevant because he's in the White House now. But I can accept the fact that he's incompetent. I can accept the fact that he's stupid. I can accept the fact that he's underqualified. I can accept all those facts.
All right. You got power.
All right. Just one fool at a time, everybody. Okay, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yes, Sonja.
I'm sorry.
What's either your or the
black community candid opinion of Ben Carson.
Oh, God. And I, you know what? And see, and let me say one thing. That's what's happening on social media. And that's why I posted the other day that I need to stay out of these debates about Trump, because it's very emotional for me. I get on the attack mode real quick. That's your candidate, and that's your choice. And so the stupid, all those things are really my true feelings about him. But my answer is yes, I can accept that he won, but he is not my choice. A president, the most qualified person.
Well, Obama was a catastrophe, but I accepted him.
One fool.
I doubt it seriously if you did. But go ahead. I doubt it very
all right,
seriously.
All right, all right.
Give me 1 second, sir.
Wait. Okay, now, Dave. Sing.
Well, I didn't answer him.
I'm sorry, Charlie. I just totally got confused. Okay, go. Okay. Yeah. Okay, go on. I'm sorry.
But now, why you want to ask the black woman about Ben Carson?
Well,
that's
not fair.
Because he's an agent provocateur, that's why.
Yeah.
You see, Charlie's the... Okay. I thought you meant Ben Carson was one.
No, Charlie is.
Oh,
well, you know their favorite word from Ben Carson. He's a fool. But anyway, that's not it is. It rhymes with fool. I think it's cool. But anyway, what was he doing there? Anyway, where did he come from, and what was he doing in politics, and why is he still there?
Okay.
Just because he's a surgeon, make you qualified to be running for president. How did he get that far? I mean, it's just some kind of clown act or something.
And
no disrespect to him as a black man. That don't have anything to do with him being a black man. It has something to do with him being another fool.
Okay. Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Oh, okay.
You go ahead. Go on. You had more to say. No, you're the one.
It's amazing. And then he's still there. He won't leave. Yep. He won't go away. I mean, it's like he doesn't. He can't catch a thought. It's like, you should leave now. I mean, and you should not be head of hood. You should leave now.
All right.
That's my opinion.
Okay, could I say something real quick about Ben Carson? This is just what I know about Ben Carson. That he was a doctor, and again, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but he ran for president. There was a conservative commentator named Armstrong Williams, who is also black, and another man named William Crystal, who is white, and who is also a frequent commentator on TV, and they got Ben Carson to run for president. Mm-hmm. This is how he became a national celebrity, mm-hmm. and this ultimately resulted in him joining the Trump campaign when his own presidential campaign didn't work out, and that's what led to him becoming the Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, and getting an exhibit dedicated to himself at the National African Museum of African American History. Well, you heard about that? Yeah. Okay. So all right, Angela, did you?
Okay, Miss, as you know, you're over 40, right, ma'am?
Yes.
You know that this. The mayor of Chicago, this mayor and the mayor before, Daley and everything, they giving money to the black churches.
Can you speak a little louder?
That's why they're giving the okay from the black churches, the leader of the black churches, to go ahead and massacre the black. That's what is happening. It's a holocaust to black. Okay? And why don't you denounce the those so-called preachers?
Well, it's
a big problem.
He's, I'll paraphrase, he indicated that the current sitting mayor and the mayor before gave money to the black churches in Chicago to, in other words, I guess, turn their eyes on the violence and really actually do nothing to help the situation of what's going on.
Thank you for the translation.
Okay.
Thank you.
And why don't I deny the black churches? Well, I'm agnostic. I mean, they don't get anything from me. I don't recognize them anyway. I will give them my due respect. I know quite a few. Everybody's preaching and a prophet. Good for you. But that doesn't affect me, okay? I haven't met anybody yet. I'm sure there's someone who is qualified to tell me what the creator of the whole universe thinks and what he does and what he wants. I think the universe can speak for itself, and if it wishes, it can speak directly to me. So I don't acknowledge them in a superior way anyway, or in a leadership position anyway. But just like...
Well, man, but it's affecting the black people in Chicago.
Yes, it is. We did a program, Where Does the Money from the Black Churches Go? And as a matter of fact, we had an event once, and a representative from one of the large West Side churches came to her, and they asked her that question, and she was quite upset about being asked, because she did not feel it was our right, if you were not a member of their congregation, to ask you what you're doing with the money. She didn't feel like it was that right. We never saw her again, which is fine with me. I mean, my thoughts are not hurt about it. But I would not put the blame on any one entity in the black community for the woes of the black community. It is not a one person,
that's right,
one thing. It is multi-layered problems,
yes, ma'am.
And it needs to be addressed. And the first thing, as far as the violence and the problems on the south side of Chicago, I don't need anybody praying over dead people for me. Sorry about that. I just don't really need another. Let's pray for them. Amen. Don't pray for dead people. If you're not doing anything to solve the problem, back up and shut up. We don't need to be praying. Well, God will take care of it. God ain't taking care of it.
I'm doing something. I'm writing.
Let's take care of ourselves. And until we acknowledge, and I had a big argument about this, like I said earlier, it's the city's job to protect them, and they're not doing it. If the city did not want these guns here, they would not be here. If the city and the police authority did not want this violence going on, it would not be happening. They would not permit it to happen. One of my tough questions is if 1,000 white people have been shot, if 1,000 white people had been shot, it would be something turned over in this city. It would not be permitted to happen. So the city, the federal government, all the way up to the presidency, has not protected the people.
It's a Trump out. Trump won.
All the way. It was before Trump.
But the president is denouncing.
Listen, Angelo, you can't. This is a time for questions, not for a conversation between you and the... You can't just take up all the Q&A time. Now, listen, I wanted to... I had a follow-up question to Angelo's, if I may.
You've got a question?
What?
You had a question.
No, I didn't have an answer to a question.
He gave us a five-minute speech on Ben Carson.
Yeah, so go on to the next question.
That was a statement.
Go on to the next question.
Save yours for the last.
Okay. All right. Well, what do you think about? Okay. What do you think about? What about Father Flager or T.O. Hardeman?
Hardeman, I don't know him. I think he's trying to run for office again.
He found her ceasefire.
But he was removed from that, wasn't he?
I don't know the whole story there.
I don't know the whole story either, but he's no longer with that organization. We talked about religion again over black people. I'm agnostic. Why do we need the Catholic Church and the white man running our business? We got enough black people on the south side running your business. You know, everybody want to run the file of flag. You got nothing against them, fine. But why do we need you controlling that particular aspect of our lives, like we still are slave children or something? It's unfortunate that someone else is now running it, but they feed a lot of money into that organization, into the Catholic organization. And I don't have a problem with him contributing or being a part of the solution. I have no problem with that. But I do have a problem with somebody like Spike Lee coming to Chicago, making Shy Rock, and letting Father Flager be the spokesperson for that. We have black people in Chicago. What are you doing? And feeding the money into that organization. I got a problem with Spike on that. I definitely have a problem with him on that. But I don't have a problem with him contributing to the community, because the only reason the Catholic Church was contributing to the black community, maybe their numbers was falling and they need that black money to go into their schools and keep them prepped up and keep them sending that money over to Rome. That's just my opinion. But I don't have anything against him, but I don't look to him for my leadership.
Okay. Okay. All right. Dave Singer, did you?
There are two recent developments, I mean, within the, you know, since the beginning of the 20th century, that have must have impacted the thinking of a lot of people. One, they found, and, you know, you could respond to me if you will, they found the oldest human remains in Africa, a place called the Olduvai Gorge, which means that all other branches of humanity sprang from an African root. And I was wondering, how has that impacted the black community as far as you're concerned? And two, you know, since the end of World War II, this is an old question, every African state has thrown off colonial rule. That must have been...
Every African state has what?
Got rid of colonial rule. That must have been played a large part in the civil rights movement, wouldn't you say? A worldwide movement, what you say?
Okay. I'll answer the first question first. He indicated that there have been a couple of major things happening in the 20th century that affected, I guess, everyone. And purportedly, it was the discovery of the oldest remains of a human, which were found in Africa. So purportedly, our life came forth from Africa. Well, my position on that, who's controlling that information? See, black people do not control archaeology digs. They don't control the museums. White America has gone into Africa and all over the world and secured and procured artifacts. Okay? Wait, let me answer, please. Have procured these items and hold them under their ownership. So if you're holding them under your ownership, then who's writing the news so to speak? Okay? We have very few people in archaeology that look like me. Museum curators that look like me. We don't have tenured university professors who look like me, who are controlling what is said about the artifacts that they've gone to Africa and secured that we would never ever own. We would never have back. White America has secured our history out of America, and they can feed to us what they want to feed to us as far as history, as far as what the remains are. They have fist fights over, they had a big blowout over that. Also, the other question, what was the other question?
The colonial rule.
The colonial rule. Well, just because you pulled out.
I pulled out.
Just because you pulled, okay, England, France, all of them, Dutch, whatever it is. Just because you gave up your colonial rule does not mean you gave up your power. And it also does not mean that the effect of that colonial rule has been removed. After you sucked up all the resources for 1,000 years, after you've abused the people for 1,000 years, it takes maybe 2,000 years. When will they recover from your colonial rule? Just when you've inbred it with them for 1,000 years, the effect is forever there.
Can I just add one thing? When I was a boy, I was taught that the human race began in the Caucasus Mountains, hence Caucasian or white bird.
Oh, when was that?
Well, that's a long time ago.
That was... That's all right. Yeah, listen, we need to get on. Now, that was...
Next question.
Okay, sir, did you have a question?
Yeah, at the beginning of your presentation, you were referring to some of the media, like the New York Times, I think you said Huffington Post, etc. And you were pointing out that you know, they have all these hits, and therefore, you know, how are you going to sort of go against that reality? You know, kind of like Trump is going to shut it down if he had his wish. But here's the question. It seems like those, you know, what are called mainstream media are extraordinarily biased. You know, in the sense that even today, they underplay or deny the fact that the country under, starting with Reagan, Clinton, Bush, Obama, the country has been fundamentally impoverished by the outsourcing of jobs. And that is really what got Trump elected. And to continue to sort of downplay it, deny that reality seems like a huge problem. And I noticed that all of those media tend to do that. What's your thought on that?
Well, as far as the media is concerned, I don't trust them either.
I mean, you know,
they are biased. They, just like I, if I'm doing a broadcast, I'm not a news reporter, I have not taken the pledge or any type. I slant it, of course, the way that I wish. And that's exactly what they do. Each and every, whether they're on the right, now let's be fair, or on the left, they slant it the way that they want. And each and every one of them know that they're doing that. But their listeners don't know it. So both of them, all of them, you ask me a question, and this is my response. They're all biased.
Yes. Okay.
Each and every one of them.
All right.
Each and every one of them are biased.
Okay. Raj.
When I read what you're going to talk here, and I got a feeling you will talk about hard questions, that do you talk to the people who commit crime there, people who kill, and do you talk about taking kids to school and making sure that they stay there? Do you talk about training black men when they go for a job, how to interview, they are trained, they are dressed right? Do you talk about these questions? And because Obama, 8 years, he promised one America. And do you talk what he did for one America in a black community?
Talk what he did for white America, which is that?
No, black America. I mean,
oh.
These are the questions do you talk about.
Oh, okay.
Those are the hard questions.
Okay. To me. As far as the hard questions are concerned, we talk about a lot of different things regarding, like the first question, about our culture, about our heritage. As far as talking about, and yes, it would be a question about training. It would be a question about, a tough question would be an example of, if you picked up the phone and said that your child had just murdered someone, what would your response be? That's a tough question. So we do talk about those things in the book. Like I said, there's 90 questions. No, we don't talk about job training in the book. This is something totally different. We are aware, and I don't know if you were here, I just came from a job and skills training event. Well, it's my contribution is to try and get the information about. There's so many programs in Chicago. One thing about the violence in Chicago, and I'm gonna say this, the people who are controlling the minds of the people who are committing the violence, not interested in jobs and training. So we have to change the dialogue. I'm a Wayne Dyer fan. We have to change the dialogue and the conversation with young black people, because the people who, like I say, who are leading them down this path that they're going are not interested in jobs and training. They're interested in using them up. So us as a community must constantly have this conversation. It must overwhelm them, because the powers that be are very overwhelming. That is influencing them. So yes, the tough questions do, from A to Z, talk about all those different things that you asked me. It does. Those questions are in there. And like I said, on Tuesday and Wednesday, if you go to Amazon, the book will be there free for you. Okay?
All right. I see that George and Shirley have their hands up. Now, you both had questions already, and I think we do have enough time to go into a second round of questions, but before we do, I always ask, is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? All right, sir, in the back, did you have a question?
Yeah, I was wondering how you resolve the question that your slave masters were Bible reading, holy Christians, and they enslave you. And now you're practicing their religion, and you accepted it. So aren't you, can't you make the same mistake they did by doing it?
No, I didn't say I was agnostic. I'm not practicing anybody's religion. I'm agnostic. I'm not practicing anybody.
Oh, no. I'm talking in general because I wonder how the black man resolves that question, the fact that, you know, my slave master was a real holy Christian and he enslaved me, and all of a sudden I'm practicing his religion. How do they negotiate there?
I can't speak for those who practice the Christian religion or any of it. I can't speak for their mindset or how they come to a conclusion that they believe in the Bible or just God one day created this universe. And I don't know how they come to that conclusion. I can't say how they come to that conclusion. I don't know how they come to such a conclusion.
Sometimes I was wondering whether your name was taken off, your religion was taken off, but you... Like every other human being needs a religion, so I take it.
That's fine, and it's great. I was raised in the church, and I'm sure some of my ethics and my morals came from the church, but I'm going to go with, you know, what the Pope said there. I mean, it's the only thing I probably agree with him in. It's probably better to be an atheist than a bad Christian. some of the worst people on the planet, excuse me, Christians, that I've run into have been Christians. But anyway.
All right now, Carl, do you have a question?
Yeah, I do have a question. I'm not sure how to phrase it. I know during your presentation you said you couldn't understand why thousands of women were also protesting in London during the Women's March here. But maybe what I'm asking is, can you not see the perspective of the people that live in England? Because there may be like a minority in the sense that the United States is the greatest country in the world, and you got a guy that has his finger near the button, and they would be annihilated if something went wrong. So can you understand? It was
sarcasm. It was sort of a joke. Okay. I can see that. I can see the whole world's concern, and the whole world is actually concerned, and they have a reason to be. They very much have a reason to be.
Prime Minister of England is pro Trump.
You're talking about this lady who became prime minister?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Listen.
He's a Trump supporter.
All right. There's a gentleman over here who had a question. Go ahead, sir.
Solidly.
That voice.
I may have
I
to repeat.
I want to ask about the gap between white students and black students. Do you have some kind of explanation?
Well, the explanation is historical. There's always been a gap ever since we've been in America. There's always been a gap, and really, if you look at it realistically, the gap is still the same. It hasn't closed. People won't care for me saying this, but I'm going to say it anyway. And I've had arguments with this about it, and teachers don't like me when I say this, but very particularly black teachers don't like me when I say it, and black administrators don't like me when I say it. One of my co-partners and I had a big blowout over it. If we talk about students who cannot read, simply cannot read and do basic math, okay? How can a student go to school from K to 12 or K to 8, get to 8th grade, and not be able to do basic math problems and read at a certain level? Or have not been diagnosed prior to that as having special needs and problems, and those special needs and problems not addressed? And see, they keep talking about it's a money gap. There is a money gap. It's an obvious money gap in the amount of money distributed to black schools and white schools. Yes, it's obvious, and it's racism. We know that, and it's economics. We know that. But you cannot say to me, as a black teacher, I've taught in the Chicago public schools. You cannot say to me that a child can get from K to 8 without reading when he's been in school 8 years. Then who are these teachers that he passed by in those 8 years who did not do their jobs? Because somebody didn't do their jobs 8 years. And that's not a money thing. It's picking up a book and teaching a child to read. Well, the books are old. If the book was 1822 and it was in English, you can teach a child to read from it. Well, they're not going to be able to pass tests. We're not talking about passing tests. Yes, they would fail the standardized test because it requires some other things. But we're talking about basic reading, basic writing, basic math. Who did not teach these young black people basic skills, including how to conduct themselves in a classroom? Who was standing in front of them? It wasn't the white man standing in front of them. And it's not money. So the...
Don't the same teachers teach black kids and white kids?
Whoever the teacher...
There's good teachers
and bad teachers. Whoever the teachers were failed these students. That is my point. That is my point. That is the first disparity. Because once they fail, once they cannot read, then what are they going to do in high school? They can't read the information. They can't do the math. They're failed in life, and it's hard to catch up. That's the first disparity, okay? That is the first failure. And until we correct that problem, if you are a teacher in school, and that includes these charter schools with their messy mess that they're doing too, if you are a teacher in a school, you cannot control the behavior of the students in your classroom, then you don't need to be a teacher, because you're affecting the behavior of the other students and you affecting the other class. I'm an instructor trying to control my class. Your class is out of hand. It's affecting their behavior. You need to be fired. A lot of people should have been fired a long time ago.
Okay. Jonathan, you had a question.
On the March on Washington, King talked about how other grassroots organizers had come for a check that had been returned insufficient funds. Could you talk about the concept of reparations and how the United Nations is talking about reparations in the United States paid to survivors and family members of those who are in the United States of America due to the transatlantic slave trade as basic justice? Could you talk about that?
It is basic justice. It's very, very basic. Because isn't it very, 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 very basic that the children, the European descendants of slave owners in America, have benefited from the slave trade? That's very basic. You can deny it if you want, but it's very basic. So it's very basic that the children of slaves should benefit as well. The economic disparity, and I'm not sure how to play it out or how it should be done, I'm not talking about that, I have no clue. It's a complicated situation. The disparity of economics in this country is a bloody damn fucking shame. And I just, no, let me, sorry, I'm gonna finish this statement.
I'm sorry.
Every time I ride downtown and look at that skyline, look at all of that damn money. Come from the south side going north side. Turn around and look south. What do you see? You see shit. So to deny your benefit is a lie. You're a liar. Now how that should be done, I have no idea. But I think that it should be done. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, we got Tim. We got time for any second round of questions.
It's a 7:45. I think we ought to go to rebuttals.
Should we go on to rebuttals? All
yes.
Right. Yeah. Well, let's do that. But wait, before we do that, how about if I just ask for a second call of anybody who hasn't already had a question to ask? Oh yes, Gene. Go ahead.
You mentioned three or four times about this pussy head. How do you get that?
Oh.
Three or four times about that pussy head.
Oh, you're
oh,
talking
the
about
pussy
the women's
hat.
The hat. Yeah, you know.
What is it?
Oh, pussy hat.
Those
Trump
red
pussy.
You know, Bush Yeah. pussy grabbing president.
No, it's Trump, yeah.
Yeah. He's known as the pussy grabbing president. So the women, during the women's march, came up with this thing. It's part of their protest, or they were branding in some kind of way, or making it more exciting. I don't know. They knitted these little hats, and they named the hats pussy hats. They had two little horns. I guess they're pussycat hats. They named put two little horns up there on them.
Like cat ears.
I can give you a little
more.
Can
somebody clarify that? I think that's what it is.
I can give you.
I saw the hats. I participated in the women's march.
Okay.
And I saw women wearing these pink knitted hats and sort of squaring on top like that. So I guess it's sort of like 2 points like cat ears.
Yeah.
But I didn't even know they were called that. I never heard them called that until tonight.
You can sign up online for the Pussy Hat Project.
Okay.
Is it really?
And you can also, there's a knitting site for it.
See?
There's also, you can buy them on Etsy. Here's where all those pink hats at the Women's March originated. An article from the Los Angeles Times will bring it out. You want to see a pink on the National Mall, said Cat Coyle, owner of the Little Knittery in the neighborhood of Altwater Village. Basically, the article in the LA Times goes on to say that, all they wanted to do was something more than just show up to the 29-year-old screenwriter who lives in downtown Los Angeles, recalling how her professors at Off-Field Barnard College in New York urged her to think about problems.
Okay, Tim, I think
there's more to it online.
Yeah, but Tim, we need to move along.
I know we need to move along.
One more question.
All right, this is going to have to be the last question. George, go ahead.
You said that you were for pro-illegal aliens coming in here and refugees, you didn't say refugees, but refugees also are filled in. And how could that is dumb, because blacks compete for unskilled labor with them. And they take the jobs and the government services from blacks. How could you be for that? I don't understand that.
That wasn't the basis of me supporting them. I am going to support anyone who needs my help. That was the basis of it. I didn't say just blanket. We're not going into a 25-page document. I will support people that need my help. And I think I said in answering that question, you know, there are other factors to be considered. And I'm not saying a blanket answer, but I am going to say that I will, like Muhammad Ali, I will support it. But you have to do things in a certain way, and you have to treat people in a humane way when you do these things.
We'll send them on a plane back where they came from. That's humane.
In your mind and heart and spirit. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker, Sonja Perdue. All right. We're gonna get into rebuttals now. We're going to get into rebuttals. First off, how many people want to give a rebuttal speech? Everybody wants to give a rebuttal speech? Raise your hand. Okay. One, two, three. Keep them hands up, y'all. Four, five, six. And me, that's seven, and that's eight. So what do we got? 20 minutes each?
Four.
4 minutes each. Okay. Okay, 4 minutes each, everybody. All right. Oh, okay. We're up to 10 people now, Tim.
Well, we'll take it 4 minutes.
4 minutes. Okay.
And we'll hopefully know everybody.
Okay, you go first. You go first, John.
I say send them back. They're taking our job.
Thank you, the speaker.
You don't even know the issue.
It's only right. It's only human. It's only a sign of a true civilization that when a crime is committed, that the community talk about that crime in great detail, in thorough understanding of what actually did take place, instead of the mythology of the propagandists who would like to historically revisionize that crime. Each one of us, our whole entire lives, those of us who are non-disabled, white, male, Americans who have lived with both of our parents having a job has had the easiest life in the history of planet Earth.
Now, we might not want to admit that to ourselves, but when we do admit it, it's the first step to justice, understanding the nature of the relationship between African Americans in America who are here, not through their own choosing, but because of the transatlantic slave trade, one of the worst crimes against humanity ever. So we can begin to redeem ourselves, to reconnect with our humanness, to find our soul, to find our heart. There is no need to applause for that. There's no expectation of applause for just basically stating that people were murdered and raped and abused and stolen from their homeland. That's a problem in America. We think we need to be on stage and given applause for this. And politicians love to grandstand about this. And CEOs love to have days about having Dr. King put up there like some kind of wonderful, great guy that we all loved. In the last year of King's life, he was more unpopular than George Bush when he spoke out against the Vietnam War. In the last year of his life, there was a lot of people from his own, members of his own community were against him. That's easy to historically revisionize that part of our history. Very easy to do when you've got a propaganda machine 24/7 that says reparations isn't something that's on the table this year, and it won't be on the table next year. That's another way of saying justice is not on the table this year or next year. Now, why is this important? Because we're human beings and we love each other and we want all our families and all our communities to have a future that we can all look together, that we're on that road together, that beautiful, exhausting, sacred road towards democracy. Now, you look by the landscape of people in power right now in the United States of America, you would think by their speeches they are the most committed to racial equality and racial justice in the history of the planet. Those speeches are real good. You know, it makes me feel good to hear those speeches when I look at the text, sure. That's a beautiful thing when Bill Clinton gets up there and says he feels people's pain who have been oppressed and exploited, isn't it? That's a real beautiful thing when George Bush gets up there and sits down with a lot of members of the community that he says he's so committed to finding solutions to increasing jobs and education. But then on the other side of the planet, he likes to drop bombs on these people who have the same skin color. On the other side of the planet, he likes to disenfranchise people and tell them, oh, this is our new experiment with capitalism. You know, you're Iraqi, your oil is not under your sand, it's our oil and it's our sand.
Yeah, it's our oil.
So there's global racism, there's domestic racism, and they play us off of this bouncing off each other. Real good. Reparations, there's a great article in These Times from April 2016. I suggest everybody read it, I brought a copy. I got a lot more, but I only got 4 minutes, and I'd like to hear what everybody else has to say, too. Thank you to the speaker for being here.
Next, it's our oil. Shut up, Charlie. Keep this.
Is this for me? Oh, okay. Pass them around.
No, it's for you.
Raj. Oh, okay. Thank you.
My name is Raj Patel. Today there was election of Democratic National Committee chairman, and they did not choose young person.
No.
And same old people now controls the Democratic Party with their failed policies and their cluelessness. After 8 years of Obama, he did less for black community than Bill Clinton did. And that is same. And nobody from black community except that Travis guy, he spoke up loudly. Mayor Coleman of Detroit, long, several years back, he had a problem in one block in the black community, and people said, what to do? And everybody said, let's have a study, what is going on, let's figure out economic. And Mayor Coleman said, let's go and see what's going on. So he and a bunch of guys got in a car and went there. He said, what is the problem? The block, their problem, there are two blocks of building torn down, and they were wild. And that's what the problem was. Because it was wilderness, nothing, nobody did anything, and kids were going there and they started fighting. Okay, they fixed the problem, went away. See, it's not the idea. You got to make solution. You got to have a solution. It's not happening in America. It's not happening in a black community. Black community, the diamond legend philosophers and what do you call it, the community organizers and talkers. They're not doers. That's problem. How come Operation Push, such a big organization, such a giant organization, did not solve all these problems? Because where they see what this person was doing. Okay, let me tell you something. In Africa, a woman came from Kenya here to America. She studied. She got a PhD. And, you know, instead of getting a job here for $200,000 a year, you know what she did? She organized a little company here, and then she went back to Kenya with a decision that what is the problem in Kenya that their small business are not growing, the number of small business opening not happening. She worked for 3 years and come out with a plan, talk to every single organization, every single government institution that is involved in creating a business. After their results, okay, last year and year before, Kenya came out with the biggest rise in the small business growth. Okay, this is number of small business in those countries. So there is another guy in Uganda. Okay, so his two brothers, one brother has some art, so he can do some work, but he works all day, comes at night and does work. There is no light. Okay, so what he did, one brother rides a bicycle and creates a light, and on a dead light, they work. See, there are solutions happening. In America, there are lots of black young men that are coming out well. The problem is that the black community, they have to solve their own crime problem. I'm sorry, okay, the white people cannot solve black community's crime problem. They got to start talking to their own young people. They got to go and talk to the criminal. They got to talk and go to gang members. And they got to have courage to go and say, hey, come on, guys, you are destroying my son's life. Okay? You are destroying my job. You know what is happening in Chicago? Today, young man goes from Chicago to somewhere else and want for a job. You're from Chicago. Okay? And do you know what first thing happens? What is the criminal history he has? Thank you.
All right.
First of all, to say that the white community bears no responsibility for what's been going on in the African American neighborhoods and elsewhere across the city is just plain ludicrous. First of all, it was the racism that started it in the first place. Now, I agree that people within the black community need to step up and need to talk to their own young people. But having said that, it wasn't the black people who kidnapped themselves and brought themselves over here from Africa. It was the white people who did that. And yes, I'm in favor of reparations, and I always have been. It's no different from what the Jewish community has been demanding from Germany, Austria, and other countries. Period, end of story. Now, I'm also sorry that the gentleman who was sitting over where Don is now standing, who left early and who's a big Trump supporter, I'm sorry that he isn't here now to hear what I have to say. Because, you know, George seems to get up on this high horse here, seems to think that all liberals are Nazis, and he seems to have the idea that Fox News is like the end all and be all of the news business, when everybody knows that Fox News and Breitbart are about as reliable as Pravda and Izvestia were under Soviet rule, or as the Volkischer Beobachter, Hitler's own newspaper, was under Nazi rule. And I'm sorry, I place no stock in any of the above. I agree that the media isn't always honest, and that's why, for example, I get my news from both CBS and NBC, and not just from one or the other. But I consider CBS and NBC to have a better, much better track record where credibility is concerned than Fox News or Breitbart. Finally, I also will say this. There also has been some sentiments expressed, not necessarily here tonight, but elsewhere, or at least at other times here. Well, why don't we give Trump a chance? And also I will respond at the same time by saying, well, Obama didn't do much for the black community. The hell he didn't. Much of what he tried to do was blocked by the Republicans in Congress, who from day one, essentially decided, well, we're not going to give this guy a chance. He's going to be a one-term president, blah, blah, blah.
Isn't that what the Democrats are doing now to Trump?
That's precisely yeah. my point.
Yeah.
Why is it that the Democrats shouldn't do that to Trump? Yeah. What is it that they expect? What is it the Republicans expect? They cannot now expect to come to us and say, well, you lost the election and you should be big about it. To hell with that.
Yeah.
We're going to give them what they gave, what the Republicans gave to us, which means we're going to give them absolutely nothing. Nada. Zero. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Mix, I agree with you all by 85%. Great, great. Because I've been discriminated to. My people in New York, they've been destroyed. Their mind been destroyed. When they go back to Puerto Rico after 30 years, not the same with the Puerto Rican in Chicago. Puerto Rican in Chicago, it's a little less. They've been discriminated to. But in New York, those bums, the ones that own the factory, they've been pushed in around really bad. But I disagree with you on many things about Trump. I'm a fair guy. I don't vote. The first time I vote was for Barack Obama because of this. Everybody cried, the first black president, all this. My wife's a little black, but that, I didn't vote because of my wife. But I was pushing to the move, you know, let's vote. But I'll make a big mistake. This guy don't stop on my principle, that bum Obama, Barack Obama. It destroyed the principle of humanity in many ways. Thanks to Trump, I discovered many things about the Clinton. And I tell you, I don't like Trump because I'm not very sure about that. He discriminated against Mexican. I got grandchildren Mexican. I got nephew Mexican. I seen the Mexican, they're okay people, you know. Puerto Rican, they're okay people. Everybody's okay people. But we gotta recognize the good thing that Trump is doing. The good thing is about, he's against abortion. I'm against abortion. He's against this bomb at the Congress, you know, the lobby, the one that buy move, okay? I'm against that. I realize I'm a thinker. I got almost 4,000 tweets on Twitter, you're gonna see that. It's in Spanish, but you can translate it. You got a translation there. I'm a thinker. I love that. I love to think deep. I'm like you. You're my sister.
You did it well.
But the world benefit more Mexico. I think this Trump is doing a good thing to Mexico. Now the Mexican corrupt, druggy politician, druguista, now they've been forced to do their job because now they have to create jobs. And who is doing that? Trump is doing a great favor to those people because they need to take care of their own people. And what they've been doing for many years is to lean on the American with this money they sent over there. They're a bunch of, there's nothing worse than Mexico government. Well, the Puerto Rican government is copying from the Mexico. And they copy the willing and dealing from the American politician. They don't rob directly, they rob the people through loans. This garbage loan, chatarra loan, the politician Puerto Rico, they borrow that money instead of creating this and that. No, they borrow from the Wall Street scum. And that's why Puerto Rico now is bankrupt, because of politicians. But the American politicians, they're not doing anything about it because here they do about the same thing.
Okay.
The Puerto Rican just copy the bad thing from this country. So I don't agree with you hating Trump completely. No, I want to see what they're going to do with the drugs in Puerto Rico. Because in Puerto Rico, nothing worse. You can, you know, you go on vacation, it's okay. But if you go over there to live like me and make a big mistake, 1989, the drug is everywhere. Thanks to the consumer from America, and I'm there. So, I'm sorry. Recognize the good thing about Trump, and the bad thing, I recognize it too. Oh, that's it?
Yeah. Time's up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm going to sit here tonight and make an admission that I don't think I have before to the crowd. I discriminate.
What?
And I judge people. But I do so on the premise that Dr. Martin Luther King said, on the content of their character rather than the color of their skin. I can point to two examples of some black employees that I used to work with. Both were the first ones to scream about discrimination. They were both the first ones to scream about lack of equal opportunity and how the black person's getting shafted. But you know why they were getting shafted? Because they were lazy, they could not be counted on to get projects done, and they could not be counted on to get things done. Versus a couple of other black employees that I knew at the same time. They kept their mouths shut about discrimination. They worked hard, they had a good reputation and a good rapport, and guess what happened? They started succeeding. I can also tell you about some people I know who are very big people who say, I hate illegal aliens, I hate this, and they're some of the biggest Fox News people watching around. What do I say about their character? It is sorely lacking, because they will also be the first ones to complain about restaurant health not being reliable, about how prices keep going up, and talk about all the ills that America goes through. I will also tell you about another guy who's a straight up business owner. He runs a small factory. He hires a lot of lower wage workers because that's what the market prevails. He treats his employees well. But is he discriminatory? No. He hires anybody who's willing to do the job, and he has a very well-integrated shop. People leave the jobs after all once they get a little bit more educated. But let's face it, as a 55-year-old white guy, I don't have much to complain about, because we usually are the ones who solve problems. We usually are the ones who try our best. Now, racial discrimination is nothing new in our country. It goes all the way back to our early Revolutionary War and with the questions of slavery. And no, our Declaration of Independence did not address black concerns. Why? Because of the economic value that slaves had provided. But 100 years later, we were split in two because of a civil war, and that question was finally decided. Now, for me, I really think discrimination for the black person ended around the 1960s with the adoption of the Civil Rights Act. Oh. It takes about a generation or two for people to fully integrate into society. And right now, we're seeing, finally, the assimilation of the black person into the mainstream of American society, just as the Irish have done, just as a lot of the others have done over the years. America is not a culture that is of tribal essence like a lot of the other countries of the world. We're a set of shared values. We're a welcoming country. We try to espouse the values of democratic freedom. We have a legislature that might not work the best, but this is not the first time we've seen the divisive politics. You can even go back to the time of Jefferson and Hamilton and see, just from the adoption of the Constitution, the abolition of the Articles of Confederation and the development of the first U.S. Treasury, that these problems are nothing new. And the debate of these things have gone on many times. To make a long story short, yes, I discriminate, but not on the color of their skin, but on the content of their character. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, who else wishes to give a rebuttal speech? All right, what about you, Charlie? Do you want to go?
No.
What? Do you want to give a, okay, does anybody else want to give a rebuttal speech?
Charlie won't give a rebuttal,
All right. Then we'll let the Charlie goes, and then our speaker will move on.
Oh, actually, we got enough time. I can give a rebuttal speech myself.
Well, give me a second.
Yeah.
All right, let's thank our speaker. Very good. I've collected numerous issues here, and I'll be eclectic as usual. The thing that amazed me about this election was the fact that the results, I didn't expect the members of the black community to vote Republican. They never really have. But the results were, I believe, rather conclusively, that they voted Democratic 100%, which was amazing. I don't think anywhere, and I've studied a few elections over the years, that anything like that has ever happened. You've come close, maybe 93%, something like that, but 100% is simply unheard of. Now, what did the Trump campaign do to make the voters totally vote against him is singularly amazing in the history of the elections of the United States. That's for so many that think he did the perfect campaign, that's an indication they probably didn't know what they were doing. Now, one of the things that disturbs me about this election, I don't like to talk about this too much, was just defined as the tax and spend. And many people in rural areas felt that the government was taxing them and spending it on the cities. And that was one of the reasons for the high turnout in some of the rural areas. I think that's not the way we should be voting. And that's rather discouraging to me. But if that's what motivates people, I don't know what we can do. Now, regarding reparations, as the young man is there, there are many ethnic and racial groups, if you study history, who have had all sorts of discomforts brought upon them. Were they the same as slavery? Within my own lifetime, there was enormous flow of displaced persons into the nation who experienced all sorts of difficulties historically. My own ethnic group could conceivably claim reparations from the Tsar of Russia. Depends on how far you want to go on this, but I think the number of claims that could be filed would be in the hundreds. Now, there's one other thing about reparations. There's things in English called settlements. And the idea of a reparation is called, the Latin term is status quo ante, to make the individual whole. But how do you're not making anybody whole who experienced this discomfort 100 or 150 or more years ago, that it doesn't apply. You're not making those individuals whole because they're generations away from the situation that is the basis of it. So it serves no utilitarian purpose. And I might have some issues on that. Now, the final thing I'd like to talk about, and I was involved in this, I've been thinking about this, is that they've had some assignments to the cabinet. And these people, I have questionable, like the Attorney General of the United States enforces certain situations. And among them is the Equal Opportunity EEOC cases, the public. They very often act as in a discrimination case, they will represent the person, the government does, and assist you in that regard. But if they don't do that, these cases aren't going anyplace. Because you'd have to literally have to self-finance it, and you'd have to have a pretty significant source of wealth, well beyond the average person. And quite frankly, I don't think anybody, what I'm getting to is, I think we're in for a period of several years in which discrimination will not be challenged legally to any considerable extent.
No, it's
what happened. I know the thing, and I'm not going to do it anyway. But that happened a number of years ago in the previous administration with the labor laws. There was no enforcement, and there was nothing you could do about it. It's not disheartening. But anyhow, I think we'll roll up our sleeves. This guy's going to get kicked out for being a treasonous. He's got to make a deal with that Russian guy. He's going to get thrown out anyway. But thanks a lot. All right, come again when you got another one in here.
Okay. All right.
He's going to get thrown out.
Next rebuttal.
This is a guy who doesn't even know what they have to protest for.
Wait. Gene, you got to let this gentleman has first dibs. He has to go before you, okay?
Yes, I'm Dan Bader. I want to make a couple of comments concerning, I forget who brought it up, about the intelligence differential or the performance in school differential between Caucasians and the African Americans. And I think there's a lot of variables that go into this and they need to be considered. I taught an eighth grade class and also sixth and seventh grade social studies in a school that was almost totally black. Here's some variables that go into play. There are important nutritional differences in the two communities. A lot of times in any community, regardless of the race, if it is a near poverty or poverty community, a lot of times kids are going into school without eating breakfast, or they're going in consuming, you know, sweet beverages and other kinds of junk food. Now you cannot, the average, there's always some exceptional kids who under any conditions can assimilate knowledge and focus their attention. But the average kid can't do that. So if you cannot assimilate the information that is being given to you in school, it's very hard to go forward. You know, it's just kind of a almost logical thing. There are other variables besides the nutrition, which is a key variable. And we also have the reality that in neighborhoods that are near poverty or poverty, they tend to evolve cultures where there is a lot of aggression. There's a lot of frustration and anger in general in communities that are experiencing poverty or near poverty. There's a lot of alcohol consumed, well, everywhere, but in those communities it really occurs. That contributes to aggression problems. But if you're a kid and you know you're in first grade, second grade, and you're going out in the morning and you have not consumed breakfast, or even worse, you've consumed junk food, which gives you blood sugar dysregulation, you're not in very good shape. You're going to be more anxious, you're going to be more irritable. And then you have a bunch of kids the same way. And then there's the bullying, the fighting, the teasing. Now you try to imagine learning in that kind of environment. And then you compare it to something out in Wilmette, Winnetka, some of these very wealthy communities, Lincoln Park. It's totally different. The average kid is coming in there with a reasonably good breakfast. The nutrition is generally so much better. They go to schools where they don't have to worry about being assaulted. And yes, there still is, you know, the teasing and so on. But when you compare the two situations, the kids in these better schools are able to assimilate knowledge and build a foundation for critical thought as they go forward. And I think to talk about the racism, there's lots of racism. I mean, actually, you know, from all sides. I've rarely met very many human beings who aren't racist to some degree against someone, you know, regardless of where they come from. And so I just want to say, when you're talking about these things, I think it's important to include these other variables. Yes, thank you.
Good evening, friends of Slim Brundage. You mentioned about kids going to school hungry. I've seen a lot of wasted food. The kids, they don't like the food, they just waste some of the food. And if I had you in charge, we would talk today about the Oscars. Tomorrow the Oscars on TV. And the question mark, there's a big question mark here. About a year or so, I bought a question mark. It was like a metal thing about 4 inches, a question mark. I bought it because I know who discovered or invented the question mark. Does anybody know who discovered invention?
Puerto Rican. No, Slim Brundage.
It was Socrates. Socrates. Really? If you're Socrates, if you're so wise, why aren't you rich? What are the riches? Where's wisdom? That's Socrates. Okay. And you mentioned about that. You don't pray for the dead. Well, the Maccabees say they did pray for the dead. You know, Maccabees. And math. You mentioned basic math. My ex-wife's cousin. He was in high school. He carried the multiplication table with himself. He couldn't stand the multiplication table in high school. And mentioned who's this guy? Billy Crystal. Crystal was a great fanatical New York Yankee fan. And Howard Cosell. I miss kind of Howard Cosell. Everybody hated him, but I miss him now. And Ali. I found out a magazine once. They said Muhammad Ali was the greatest athlete of all time. I don't know. I probably think of Jim Thorpe or Babe Dietrich and Zaharias. And number three was Jordan was number three all-time great athlete of all sports. And number 21 was none other than Secretariat, the horse. Secretariat was number 21. And that's about it. Yeah, they had the numbers. I also found magazine, the greatest number, from 00 to 99. 00 was Jim Otto, and 99 was Gretzky. And Gretzky said that Gordie Howe was the greatest in Mr. Hockey. And the number 9 was for Gordie Howe.
Thanks, I'll keep track.
But I would give number 9 to Ted Williams, I think. And that's probably...
What?
Ted Williams, number 9, over... Howard Gordie Howe.
You can ramble.
That's it.
Okay.
Great.
All right.
Now, all right. Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech?
All right. Not
no.
Done,
okay.
You're
well, I will. First of all, I'd like to again thank our speaker Sonja Perdue for coming here. And all right, so let's give her a big hand. Let's give it up for Sonja Perdue. All right. You know, I thought this was a really good presentation tonight. I really enjoyed it. One of the things you said tonight is you're talking about white people fighting each other, and it's almost like on cue. At the exact moment you said that, I got into an argument with Dave Travis sitting over there about the tuition, which he was reluctant to pay. I asked him several times. Each time he said, "I'll pay you when I'm ready." And so I just walked away. And finally, you know, I got a little bit more insistent, and then he called me a fucking jagoff, which he's not here right now. I'm sorry he's not here, because I would have wanted to tell him this to his face, but I actually consider being called a fucking jagoff by him to be a badge of honor. So I will not hold it against him and call him for violating the no personal attacks rule.
You're a lady here.
All right, because from him I consider that a compliment. Now,
why?
Well, because of the source. Okay, now. But I can't really get into that without committing a no personal attacks rule myself.
Are we allowed to send any words? There are ladies here.
Okay.
Oh, wait a minute. That's a good point.
Yeah.
We're volunteer driven. He's volunteered to collect adult And there's no reason to give this guy a hard time.
Yeah. All right. Now, okay, thank you. Thank you, Charlie. All right. Now, I just want to say, you know, I think a lot of people are prejudiced. I mean, we talked about prejudice tonight, and I think it's very hard to avoid prejudice. I know I have to struggle every day against it myself, against prejudging people, because prejudice is judging people before all the facts are in. And I think that almost everybody, whether they're white, black, or you know, whoever they are, it's very hard to avoid that, to start generalizing about people. But if you know, and to start holding people responsible for the actions of some. You're a member of a certain group, and because of your membership in that group, you are responsible for the actions of other people in that group that you had nothing to do with. I think everybody has a tendency to do that. What I hear, for example, I hear white people blaming blacks collectively for the actions of the gangster disciples. I hear, and unfortunately, I've spoken to black people who have blamed me for the actions of the slave owners.
Okay.
I think it behooves us to think of each other as individuals and stop doing this. You are a member of this group, so I blame you for this. And if you blame all members for the actions of some, you're not going to get very far in trying to talk to people, you know. Would you yourself want to be blamed this way?
No.
No. No. Nobody would. Now, on the subject of media bias, it's kind of a related subject. I think everybody has their own point of view. I think that the point, you know, is to try to be objective. And not let your own point of view, your own personal biases or prejudice prevent you from seeing the truth. Worst of all is to lie on behalf of your cause. Nobody's going to believe you once you do that, you know. And I've heard all kinds of people do that. Now, how much time I got left, Tim?
Well, you got basically 5 seconds.
5 seconds. Okay. Well, that's pretty much all I wanted to say.
All right, let's get your speaker gets the last word. Go right ahead, and the mic's yours for another 5-10 minutes.
5 minutes, okay.
These guys are failures.
We got a wine from the back, Charlie. Okay. Thank you. It's been great. It's been great. I can't speak for all black people. I just can't do it. You can barely speak for me some days. But I'm going to take what Dan said, because I have a tendency to blame all white people for everything that ever happened from the beginning of time. But anyway, I'll try and say some white people sometimes.
I didn't do it.
Sometimes I will. And we do have a tendency to do it. It's all over social media. White people did this. White people did that. White people did that. White people did that. Black people did this. Black people did that. This person did that. And we do that. Just want to lay the blame somewhere, don't we? Instead of having our own sense of social responsibility, it's much easier. It's so much easier to say you did it than to say I did it, or maybe I should do it differently, or maybe I can do it better, or maybe we can do it better. And one of the things that is taking place in America right now, and I'm pretty much going to leave it at this, we don't see ourselves as we, and we do not see ourselves as Americans. Because if we did, 95 of these dialogues would not be taking place.
Right.
Yeah. We do not see ourselves as Americans. We see as a separate, they're like 95,000 different separate American factors. Mm-hmm. And if we saw ourselves as Americans, the story would be written totally, totally different. And that's not how we see ourselves. Absolutely, 100% not at all. And I don't know if it will ever happen. It probably will not. But until that happens, And until we could have no sympathy for what happens to other people, you know, even though there are illegal immigrants, everybody here is illegal. If you would truly admit it as to how this republic came to be, each and every one of us is illegal. You may never want to admit that to yourself. You may never admit it to yourself, but this republic is a bloody republic. And it came to be on the deaths of many, many, many people. And until you're willing to admit that, you're gonna see us all as more important than the other, which is really not the truth. I'm going to say the final thing. There was a purportedly, and NASA wants to use these words again, just like Columbus. They're teaching Columbus discovered America and all this other kind of crap. They discover these seven planets orbiting around TRAPPIST and that type of thing. They were found. I use the word revealed. At this particular time, that was revealed to us. They've already existed out there. You just didn't know they were out there. So it was revealed to us, just as this administration is revealing everyone's prejudice. Everyone, and I have said many times in social media, you need to see who's saying what, because these people who are saying certain things, it's not like I haven't been out there cussing on high. I'm trying not to. I'm trying to stay out of debates. I really am. Have jobs where they make decisions. They have decision-making jobs where they affect their lives, black people's lives. And if they're on social media and they're saying certain things and they're in certain positions, they need to be checked, and they can be checked. Because if you're in a position that affects your decision-making in that job affects my life, or my public policy, then you need to be removed for that job, or you need to shut up about your prejudices. But my book will be available Tuesday and Wednesday, Sonja Cassandra Perdue. I want to thank you, and the ebook will be available free on Amazon Tuesday and Wednesday. I'm going to write that down and make a note. Thank you so much.
All right. And we're out of here.
That's a wrap. That's a wrap. Well, thank you very much.